Hello folks, welcome back to the Acer Phone channel and thanks for tuning in. In this particular video I want to discuss 5 tips to improve your Acer photography. So without further ado, let's get into it. If you're new, my name is Wieder Oermans and I'm an amateur astrophotographer living in Utrecht, the Netherlands. And on my channel I share equipment reviews and tutorials that will hopefully also help you to improve your own astrophotography skills. If you like that kind of content, please consider subscribing to my channel by clicking on the bottom right of the screen. I would highly appreciate that. And let's move on with the video. Let's get into that first tip. And the first tip is, use software to polar align your equatorial mount. And I know that in the first couple of years I used my polar scope that was inside my equatorial mount to align my mount with the north celestial pole. But the last 2 years I have been using software, and in particular I have been using SharpCap to polar align my equatorial mount. And that really helped me to increase the accuracy of my guiding. What I wanted to show you is just a quick clip on how to use SharpCap to polar align your equatorial mount. I also have a more extended video on how to polar align your mount, getting through all of the steps. If you're interested in that kind of information, I will put a link in the description below this video. So in SharpCap you basically have the tools menu, so when you click on that you can see polar align, and when you click on polar align, SharpCap will immediately take a picture of the north celestial pole in my case, and then it asks you to press next and then rotate your RA axis on your equatorial mount. So the way you do that is just you can loosen up the clutch as you can see here, and then you turn your RA axis at a 90 degree angle and then you tighten the clutch again, and then after that SharpCap will ask you to press next and it will take a second picture of the north celestial pole, and then it will decide on your polar align error. And you can see here in my case I have about 11 arc minutes of polar align error. And this is after I visually polar aligned my equatorial mount. So you can see here that it's really useful to use software such as SharpCap. And so you can see here that of course we can then reposition the mount by using the altitude and the azimuth bolts that are on your mount. So I'm using the azimuth bolts here by loosening up one bolt and tightening the other. And of course the same goes for your altitude bolts. So you can loosen up one bolt and tighten the other one to change the position of your equatorial mount. And my advice would be, make very small corrections, because that already results in like arc minutes of changes in your polar alignment. And the goal would be then to have a polar align error of less than 1 arc minute. I really noticed that this helped me to improve my my tracking and also to improve my guiding. I had about half an arc second higher accuracy in my PhD2 guiding when doing the SharpCap procedure as compared to not doing this procedure. So let's move on to the second tip.
The second tip is actually, choose a deep sky object that fits your field of view. In the first couple of years I just started out doing astrophotography, and sometimes I would select a small target like a planetary nebula or a galaxy. It would appear as a very small target in my picture, in my field of view. And of course then you will not see a lot of details on that target. So I will explain a little bit how you can calculate the field of view for each of the deep sky objects that you might be interested in imaging. So let's take a look at that and then move on to the third tip.
I would highly recommend that you go to astronomy.tools. You can see it here, astronomy.tools, because it's a really useful website when you want to know stuff like this. So when you go back to astronomy tools and you go to field of view and you click on imaging mode, you might remember that we saw that the Andromeda galaxy is about 3 degrees. So we can now check whether or not the Andromeda galaxy will fit in my field of view. So you can choose here an object. So I clicked on imaging mode, field of view, imaging mode, and we can select M31, which is the Andromeda galaxy. And of course, then we can say my custom focal length of my custom telescope is 480 millimeters, and I have an aperture of 80 millimeters. And the camera I'm using is the ZWO
ASI 1600 Mono Pro. And when your camera or your telescope is not mentioned, you can just click on a custom camera or custom telescope, as I did right here. And then you can just write down the information about the resolution and your pixel size right here. And when we add then this camera and this telescope to the field of view, you can just actually see how big the deep sky object will appear in your picture when using this particular telescope and this particular camera. Now, let's also check out M51, which is the Whirlpool Galaxy. Yeah, you can see here that the Whirlpool Galaxy is a lot smaller. It was about, I think, 15 arc minutes or something. So you can see here that my field of view of 2 by 1.5 degrees, it's far larger as compared to the deep sky object that I am interested in imaging. I don't know, you might already know that I also own a ZWO-178. So when I put that information of that camera in, so when I add this one to the field of view, you can see that you can even save the image. It's really beautiful. You can open it up. So you can see here, when I'm using my ZWO ASI 178, I will get this picture, which zooms in a lot more on the Whirlpool Galaxy, basically. So that's pretty interesting, I think, at least to know. So astronomy tools, it's really, really useful.
Over the course of the years, I just first started out visually focusing my telescope and camera on the night sky, and sometimes I noticed that I was a little bit out of focus after an entire imaging session. So what you can do is use some software that shows you the full width, half, maximum, and it really helps you to check whether or not you have the best focus on your deep sky object. So I will show you what this measure actually is and how you can use software that will show you whether or not you are completely and accurately focused. And thereafter we will talk about the fourth tip.
So this is just a quick explanation on how to use software to focus your camera and telescope on the night sky. So we are here in Sequence Generator Pro, and Sequence Generator Pro has a frame and focus module. You can basically set the binning and exposure time, and then when you press start, Sequence Generator Pro will start taking pictures of your of the night sky. And it produces in this case an HFR figure. This is actually the half flux radius. And what you need to know is that the lower those values are, basically the better your camera is focused on the night sky. So you can see here that the HFR, it refers actually to the brightness of your star, and it looks at the radius from the center of that star to a point where the star is at about 50% of its energy. And so yeah, similarly, the full width at half maximum, it just looks at the diameter of a star. And you can see that when your star is out of focus, the star will appear larger in your field of view. So the lower the value is of the HFR, or the full width at half maximum, the lower the diameter or the radius actually is of that star, and the better you are in focus. So just remember, experiment a little bit and turn your focuser until you have the lowest value, the HFR value or the full width at half maximum value, so you know that you are perfectly focused on objects in the night sky.
The fourth tip is actually divided into three subparts, and it has to do with increasing the accuracy of your auto guiding when you use PhD2. So the first basic tip I want to give you is that you have to use the ASCOM driver that is available for your mount in PhD2. So let me elaborate a little bit on that. So when you buy an auto guiding camera and maybe a tracking scope and an auto guiding camera, this camera will come with an ST4 cable. And this ST4 cable, you can connect it to the camera, and the other side goes into the auto guiding port of your mount. And this is one way for PhD2 to send corrections from your camera to your equatorial mount. But actually, a better way to do that is to download the ASCOM driver that is available for your mount, and then also directly connect your mount to your laptop or desktop or PC or whatever you use, and then send the corrections via ASCOM, because that connection allows you to talk to your mount more quickly and also accurately as compared to using an ST4 cable from your camera to the mount.
So in PhD2 you can of course select your driver for your mount, and what you should not do then is to select the ST4 driver, And as you can see here, I'm selecting the ESCOM driver for my Celestron AVX mount. And yeah, you can just connect the ESCOM driver and then close and start PhD to guiding.
So the second tip I have for you is, yeah, use the guiding assistant that comes with PhD2 guiding. The guiding assistant calibrates like your equipment that you are using for auto guiding, and then it will input the correct settings into PhD2. And I really noticed that this helps you to increase the accuracy with which you can guide in PhD2.
So when you are in PhD2, you can just go to the tools menu and select guiding assistant. And importantly, you should already be guiding. And yeah, then the guiding assistant, it will actually stop your auto guiding, and it will track the mount for about 2 minutes at least. I'm always tracking for about 4 or 5 minutes at minimum, so you get some reliable values on how your mount is tracking the stars in the night sky. And then as a second step, this assistant will start pushing your mount in RA index. So it will calibrate your mount, pushes your mount north, south, and east and west. After which it will come up with the values you can here press on apply, and it will input those values to accurately guide your mount in RA and DEC. And so you can here see the profile of my backlash, and I have a problem with my AVX, but that is of course my problem and not yours. So yeah, I noticed that using the guiding assistant, it really improves the accuracy with which you are you can guide. And yeah, so very useful.
So the third tip I have for the PhD2 is actually that sometimes it helps when you just correct for one particular trend. So you can select in PhD2 a guiding that you will only correct for arrows going up or north, or arrows going down or south. And this is especially useful when you notice that you have a lot of those curves in PhD2. So you go, your declination axis goes up, PhD2 corrects for it, then your declination goes down, your guiding, and then PhD also corrects for it, and you have these curved paths. And then when you just correct for north or correct for south, you can often see that those big curves, they start to disappear. So this is just one extra tip that helped me personally to improve my auto guiding. So the final tip I have is take it easy. Yeah, this is of course very general, but I often remind people that astrophotography is a marathon, not a sprint. And you have to learn so many things. So you have to learn how to set up your equipment, you have to learn how to polar align, to track, to auto guide, to capture your images, to post-process those images. And all of those steps, they require time and effort, and you inevitably, you will have some nights where everything goes wrong. So some cable doesn't work, or just when you are completely set up, some clouds will roll in, or some anomalous error will appear and you don't know why. For instance, your equipment doesn't connect, that kind of things. I have to remind you, it happens to every one of us. And during those nights, it is just, yeah, it's of course difficult, but just remember, there will always be another night. You will be able to solve that particular problem you will have. So take it easy. Everybody has some bad nights. So keep that in your mind. Don't obsess too much about those nights, and you will get there. So hi folks, we're at the end of the video. I hope you liked it. If you did, please consider giving this video a thumbs up. I would really appreciate that. And of course, I hope to see you again in one of my other videos on my channel. And until then, I want to wish you clear skies. Bye bye.